Hi, welcome everyone. Sue Humrock-Lemke. I'm the Assistant Superintendent of Pupil Services here in Simsbury. And I had the great fortune of making contact with Dr. Jeff Vanderploeg. We had actually, as a part of what we do in the school system, we had gone through some what's called mental health first aid training throughout the state. And this was a great beginning to actually spread the word and also the skill set around mental health issues. And it was through that training that I became connected with Dr. Vanderploeg. So he is here tonight to discuss with us treatment systems and service for youth surrounding trauma. So with that, please welcome Dr. Vanderploeg.
For that nice introduction. I'm going to try to project, but if anyone has trouble hearing, let me know and I'll try to speak up a little bit. We may even be able to find a microphone if we're lucky. But thank you very much for the introduction today and also just the introduction to be here to talk with you today. So I'm going to talk with you a lot today about children with mental health needs and the kinds of services and systems that are in place in the state of Connecticut to address the needs of young people and their families. But I'm also going to talk about the systems that surround service delivery and the things that are working well in the state of Connecticut, as well as the things that need to be enhanced. And I'll share several examples with you. If you have questions along the way, please don't hesitate to raise your hand. I'll take questions throughout kind of as we go along. And then I also reserve some time at the end for questions and discussion. So with that, I'll dive right into a brief description about where I'm from. I'm the Vice President for Mental Health Initiatives at the Child Health and Development Institute. And we're an independent nonprofit organization located in Farmington, right across from the UConn Health Center. And we're a subsidiary of the Children's Fund of Connecticut, which is a public endowment that focuses on children's health issues. We are self-funded through the Children's Fund, as well as obtaining grants and support from federal, state, and some philanthropic sources for contract work. And our mission is to be a catalyst for improving health and mental health and early childhood systems for kids in the state of Connecticut. And to do that, we operate at the policy, systems, and practice level. And I'll talk a little bit more about what that means and some examples at each of those levels. We do have a website that I included here, and hopefully the slides can be made available to everybody who's here today if there's things that you want to follow up on. But if you'd like to visit our website to learn more about anything that I'm talking about today, you can find a lot of resources at chdi.org. All those icon pictures on the right side are reports and documents that we've produced over the last couple of years that are available to be downloaded for free at our website. You can also go to kidsmentalhealthinfo.com, and that is a resource that was specifically designed for parents and educators around understanding the signs and symptoms of mental health concerns for children and what you can do if you suspect that there's a mental health concern for a child that is in your family or a child that's in your school. Before I get started, I do want to say one additional thing, which is a little bit unusual for me, but my parents happen to be in the back of the audience today. And after these many years of doing this work, they've never actually came and seen me present anything. So they happened to be driving out from Michigan today. And I said, well, if you can get here in time, let's go to Simsbury and you can watch me present about children's mental health and see what I do for a living. So here they are. So I just want to acknowledge my mom and dad sitting in there, nice, here in the back, making me a little bit more nervous than I usually am. So my goals for today is first to just to help understand some factors that influence development, child development, and also the prevalence as well as the signs of mental health conditions among youth. Second goal is to understand a little bit more about the structure of the children's behavioral health system in the state of Connecticut, and also to describe some system development efforts that are going on in the state, many of which we have some involvement with at CHDI, but as other things as well. And then at the end, I was hoping to have a conversation and can answer some questions and discuss ways that you can learn more about this work as well as participate in some of these system change efforts if you're interested. So we'll start with the first goal around understanding factors that influence development. First of all, I think an important point to make is that development is not a single construct. You don't move through development from here to there. Development occurs at different rates and across different domains. So for example, there's the domain of physical development, so you grow as you get older. There's cognitive development and changes in your brain functioning and how, and your thought patterns, and that development takes place over time. social, emotional, behavior development is kind of the domain of people like me who are clinical psychologists and other mental health professionals who deal with social, emotional, behavioral development. And then moral, spiritual development is also a factor. And there's lots of other domains of development. Not everything takes place at the same rate. So just to give you a very concrete example of that, you may see an adolescent in your school who's 6'3" and 210 pounds. But just because they look like an adult doesn't mean that they've developed fully as an adult when it comes to their social or behavioral, those other factors. So that's, I think, an important point to make when you think about development overall. There are also a lot of different factors that contribute to healthy development. And as I was putting this list together, it occurred to me that people spend their entire careers on one of these bullet points, right? So you can spend your entire career thinking about the role of genetic factors in development and the emergence of behavioral health conditions. You take any one of those and you have tons and tons of research and resources that are available. So this is just a very incomplete list, but just gives you a sense of a few things that influence development over time. So there are genetic factors. I was reading recently about the role of a particular gene in your brain that affects the transmission of calcium into your neurons and how that's related to development in cognition and emotional regulation. And again, there's a whole voluminous body of research around things like that. And that is actually a pretty young science when it comes to the role of genetics in mental health. Health and nutrition can affect development across all these domains. Certainly parental mental health or substance abuse conditions can have a profound impact on child development. Exposure to stimulating activities. So these are homes that have lots of books and lots of activities and things for infants to play with, and then other play activities and developmental things that kids can engage in as they get older. And that really varies from home to home, but that variance can have a tremendous impact on development. Certainly family cohesion and the emotional availability and warmth of your parents, there's a tremendous amount of research behind that. Parenting practices, a nurturing home environment, healthy caregiver relationships between parents is a significant factor. Having a safe home and a safe community is shown to have an impact on development. And even things that are broader than that, going into access to healthcare and other resources, can really impact development. So there was a researcher and theorist called Yuri Bronfenbrenner. Has anybody heard of Bronfenbrenner? So he came up with this idea around the different levels of influence that impact child development. So starting in the middle with that young child, the things that are, so to speak, closest to that child, certainly the genetic and biological factors that child brings to their own development, the home, the school environment, relationships with siblings, things that are sort of in a very close proximal environment to the child, participation in religious settings and church activities. And then if you go a little bit further out, homes, the schools that they are a part of, the neighborhoods that they live in, and even if you go further out and further out into these concentric circles, things like policies that are passed, that are implemented by the government, and legislation that's passed by the government, and those kinds of things can really influence development at a whole population level many times. So that's, I think, a useful way of thinking about development and gives you a sense of the breadth of factors that can influence children. So what are some of the hallmarks of healthy development? A child who's able to focus on their daily activities, who can think and plan, and their ability to think ahead is intact, and it's not affected by distorted beliefs or thought disorders. Children who are developing normally have normal levels of breathing and heart rate. And we'll talk a little bit about some things that can affect things as simple as your breathing and your heart rate and development. Children have some sense of control over their environment. They're alert and aware. They have a good sense of reality. They're not, have hallucinations, hearing things that aren't there. They're ready to learn and ready to participate in their education. And they're connected to others. And again, this is just a very small list of a number of things that can be connected with healthy development. So again, going back to our list, what are some of the factors that contribute then to unhealthy development? So what happens when things go a little bit awry? So once again, there can be certain brain physiology or genetic factors that contribute to unhealthy development. Even things like environmental toxins, probably many of you have heard about the lead poisoning. And there's research that shows that kids who are exposed to lead, especially infants at a young age, how that can impact development much later into childhood and even into adulthood. Lack of access to health care, so if something, if there are not prenatal visits, if there are not regular pediatrician checkups, those kinds of things can really influence healthy development over time. Harsh or inconsistent parenting, once again, having a parent that has a mental health or a substance abuse condition can set development off track. Poverty and inequities, and growing up in a severely impoverished environment and not having access to resources can also impact development. You're also, raise your hand if you've heard of this concept of toxic stress before. So this would be things like being consistently exposed to abuse and neglect in your home, or lots of community violence and shootings that are happening in your neighborhood, and the impact that can have on children as they're constantly hyper-vigilant about their surroundings. That can really have an influence. But I think the important point to make here is that it's not really any one factor that contributes significantly to development, and that can be a bit of a misunderstanding about development. Typically, it's an interaction of lots of different things that influence development over time. And lots of these risk factors tend to be common among small groups of children and families. And what I mean by that is, if you are affected by abuse and neglect, you may also have community violence, and you may also have poor schools, and you may also have lack of access to health care in your community. And it's the confluence of all these negative impacts or factors that really impact development negatively over time. And many times it's really not a question of whether it's nature or nurture. It's really both. It's both nature and nurture that contributes to development. I like this figure by Neil Halfond from UCLA. And what this shows is the development trajectories from birth on this side of the graph all the way over to 5 years and beyond. And the influence that some of these things can have to either promote healthy development or to impact development in a way that gets kids on a negative trajectory. So for example, parents who are more highly educated, who have emotionally healthy relationships and high levels of literacy, those are factors that can ensure that young people develop towards a healthier side, the green side of this figure. Same goes for reading to your child at 18 months and beyond, having appropriate discipline practices, access to health services, participating in preschool. The more of those factors that are present for children, the more likely you are to be in that green area. Okay? Now, on the other side, poverty, lack of health services, toxic stress, those are things that can kind of depress development over time and lead to young people that develop along the red line of development. So it's, I think, a helpful way to think about the complicated interaction of lots of different factors that impact development over time. So let's talk a little bit more about the prevalence of behavioral health concerns for children and how you can recognize signs and symptoms. So first of all, understanding a little bit about the numbers. So the research that's been out there for a number of years tells us that up to 1 in 5 youth will experience the signs and symptoms of behavioral health concerns that would benefit from treatment. That number is often a surprise to people. So if you do the math of, for example, I don't know what the population of Simsbury is, but if you do the math on the state of Connecticut, there are approximately 750,000 children in the state of Connecticut. So that's 150,000 kids who have signs and symptoms of behavioral health concerns that could benefit from treatment. That's a lot of kids, and probably a lot more than you might suspect. Up to 1 in 10 youth exhibit signs of serious emotional behavioral disturbances. So these are kids who really need treatment. So what are we talking about when we're talking about mental health conditions? Some of the things you may have heard have anxiety, depression, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, oppositional defiant and conduct disorders or behavioral disorders. Maybe you've even heard of post-traumatic stress disorder. If you have heard of it, you may have heard of it in the context of people returning from war and veterans. But there's more research coming out that some of these factors we were describing earlier around community violence and shootings that are commonly taking place can have a similar kind of post-traumatic stress effect on children. Obsessive-compulsive disorder, autism, schizophrenia. So these are some of the things you may have heard of before. And each of these mental health conditions impacts behavior, your feelings, your emotions, your ability to regulate your emotions, the way that you think and your cognitive functioning, and also even your physical development over time. So many times, for example, people who have severe anxiety disorders may have may experience a lot of difficulty going to sleep at night. So there can be really tremendous effects on your functioning day to day that are associated with mental health conditions. There are about, in the child world at least, about four conditions that make up just about 70% of all referrals for outpatient treatment. And the four are anxiety, depression, attention deficit, hyperactivity disorder, and oppositional defiant disorder or conduct disorder. Those are the most common presenting concerns if you were to walk into an outpatient clinic. About 70% of all youth walking through the door will have one of these four conditions. Here is something that's also often shocking to people. 70 to 80% of the young people who need treatment will never receive it. Nothing. No medication, no meetings, regular appointments with a school-based clinician or an outpatient clinician. So the vast majority of young people who have these conditions will never receive any treatment. So once again, kind of going to our number of 150,000 approximately who may have signs and symptoms, that would be 30,000 or so receive, 30 to 45,000 will receive treatment. The rest, over 100,000, will never receive any treatment, to give you a sense of what that would look like statewide. So I guess one of the take homes for us here today is that if you notice signs and symptoms and you're concerned about a young person in your school or in your home, that you consult with somebody. Talk to your pediatrician, talk to a psychologist in the community, go to the school, talk to the teachers and social workers there. I think it's really important to recognize it as a serious issue and really try to address it. I wanted to also share some information about suicide warning signs and risk factors. Suicide is the third leading cause of death among 15 to 24-year-olds. Suicide attempts are not typically done for attention. So you have to really take it seriously. You have to pay attention to what you're seeing. So some things you may want to watch out for is kids who express a suicidal thoughts or a plan for committing suicide is a huge red flag. Immediate action needs to be taken. Kids who have had a previous suicide attempt are at a much higher risk of attempting suicide again. Kids who have psychiatric disorders, particularly young people who are depressed, that's something to really pay attention to. About two-thirds of all suicide attempts involve somebody who meets criteria for a depressive disorder. Alcohol or drug abuse, sudden changes in mood or hygiene. Sometimes, especially in the day and age of social media, the peers might be the first one to know because a student will say something on Facebook or Instagram or one of these social media sites, and those can be real warning signs that something is not right and needs to be done. So one of the lessons for us in our work is how do we train other young people to be part of the mental health workforce, so to speak, by helping to recognize the early signs and symptoms of mental health and the risk for suicide. That's something we'll probably see more of over time. Feelings of hopelessness, withdrawing from typical behaviors. These are kids who spend lots of time up in their room by themselves or are isolated on the playground and not interacting with other peers. Kids who are impulsive or aggressive, even children who exhibit sort of what we might call odd behaviors like hallucinations or really unusual thoughts and statements that they make, pay attention to that. Certainly having access to lethal means, it could be firearms, it could be prescription drugs that are available in the house, that raises the risk of a suicide attempt, and recent interpersonal conflicts or situational stresses. So lots of different factors that you want to watch out for. And I think the news and the message here, once again, is you don't have to try to address these things on your own. There are lots of resources out there for people who are facing these kinds of symptoms. If you're in the midst of an emergency, like there is an active suicide attempt, certainly call 911 right away. The police will be out to help. If a child's in crisis or in distress, who here is familiar with the 211 system, or the EMPS mobile crisis system? So 211 is a great resource. We'll talk a little bit more about that later. But they are skilled, probably among the most skilled clinicians in the state around recognizing and addressing suicidal behavior. And then if you're anywhere in the country and you have one of these concerns, that the number 1-800 number below is the National Suicide Hotline, and you can reach a crisis counselor by phone anywhere in the United States. I also wanted to talk a little bit about trauma. Sue and I were talking before the presentation a little bit about the role of trauma and people's emerging understanding of trauma and how it impacts all kinds of different domains of development, academic development, social, emotional, behavioral development. So what are we talking about? You might hear the word trauma, you may not understand what it means. So trauma, the most common examples of trauma include physical abuse, sexual abuse, neglect. So these are the things that, you know, might put you in contact with DCF and a caseworker at DCF. But it can also include life-threatening accidents or injuries. So kids who have been in a serious car accident, for example, can exhibit some of the signs and symptoms of a traumatic stress reaction. Chronic illnesses or painful medical procedures are also considered a potentially traumatic event. Loss or death of a loved one, including having a caregiver that's incarcerated for a long period of time. And there's lots of other examples. Again, violence, fires, natural disasters, and exposure to war, terrorism, things that may not be as commonly experienced here. But these are all traumatic events that can have really, really significant impacts on development over time. So again, to share some of the data here about the prevalence of trauma, when you take all those different kinds, or at least a subset of them, into consideration, almost 50% of young people aged 6 to 9 have experienced some kind of physical abuse or assault. It's a shocking number for people to consider. 2% sexual victimization, 12% have experienced abuse and neglect, or have witnessed violence in their home or in the community. And you can see what the rates look like among the 14 to 17-year-old population. So really much more common than most people understand. If you take all these things into account, by the age of 17, about 71% of all young people will experience at least one potentially traumatic event. And then the frightening thing, once again, is that most trauma exposure will never be reported. So once again, a take-home point for this audience here today is ask the question and ask what's happened to young people if you have some concerns. I like showing this slide because it shows you a little bit about how trauma can impact brain development. So on the top left is the brain of a three-year-old who was developed under normal conditions. And on the right is the brain scan of a three-year-old who's been exposed to extreme neglect. And you can see just the difference in brain size and some of the gaps in development in the middle of the brain under conditions of extreme neglect. On the bottom right, once again, here is a scan. This is a PET scan looking at brain functioning, again, for three-year-olds. The one on the left is, a normal, healthy, developing three-year-old. The brain scan on the right is a three-year-old that had been in a Romanian orphanage that was renowned for conditions of extreme neglect and abuse. So what I'd like to point out here is the front part of the brain, which is responsible for things like thinking, like what they call executive functioning, setting goals, thinking ahead, impulsivity, controlling impulsivity. That's the center of the brain that is most associated with executive functioning. So you can see how the red part means that things are really firing up in that brain the way that you would expect them to. But in the brain on the right, under conditions of extreme neglect and abuse, you can see there's not nearly as much activity in red here in that scan. On the other side, down here, this side of the brain is what you might think of as the fight or flight center of your brain. So the point here is that kids who experience chronic exposure to trauma, it can have a real impact on the way that your brain develops, both inside in terms of its size as well as functioning over time. And what you find is that if left unaddressed, this young person might have a lot of trouble as they get older controlling their emotions controlling their impulses to act out aggressively in their behavior. On the other hand, they're going to be hypervigilant. They're going to be ready to go if something's wrong, because they're used to an environment that is a constant threat to them. So that just is a way to drive home this point around the role of trauma in brain development.
Jeff, the colors on that PET scan, did that show like neuron activity or brain activation? Is that what those colors show?
Yes, okay. So brain activity. So if the areas in red are areas that are highly active when you do a PET scan, which means that everything's working as you would expect. There's lots of activity in that part of the brain. But if it's green, that means there's, or the blue-black areas, is areas of less activity. And we know which parts of the brain are responsible for certain kinds of behaviors and emotional regulation, et cetera. And so if you see that there's significant differences in brain activity at the population level, you can see the impact that this has. Okay, so there was a study not too long ago, within the last several years. It's called the ACEs study, and ACEs stands for Adverse Childhood Experiences. And what this study shows is they count up the number of traumatic experiences that young people experience, and then looked at mental health functioning and physical functioning into adulthood. And what was interesting that they found are, first of all, things that you might not be that surprised by. Kids who are exposed to a lot of trauma tend to have much higher rates of mood disorders, anxiety disorders, substance abuse conditions, and impulse control disorders. But what was really fascinating about this study is that they also showed a significant relationship between childhood trauma exposure and health conditions later on in life, so that the rates of heart disease and stroke and pulmonary disorders and diabetes and STDs were much higher among the group of young people, or the group of people who experience lots of adverse childhood experiences into adulthood versus those who experience very few. So once again, it shows you sort of the important role of trauma, not just for mental health functioning, but also for physical functioning and disease over time. So what does this look like in a typical classroom when you're thinking about the prevalence of trauma? So in a classroom of about 30 students, you might find that at the bottom there, six or so of those students, based on the population data, will have no adverse childhood experiences. But then when you start to get up into the top row of students, these are the students with no adverse childhood experiences. The number of children in a classroom of 30 that may have had one adverse childhood experience, all the way down to this group of kids that have five or six. So that gives you a sense of, in a classroom of 30, you might have 6 students that have experienced a significant number of adverse childhood experiences, and how that impacts their learning and their behavior in the classroom. That's something that, as psychologists and social workers, people are really trying to get a grasp on how do we address this issue of trauma. And we know that kids who perceive threat in their environment, who have been exposed chronically to trauma, they're focused on their survival, their thinking may be impaired, their breathing and heart rate are just sort of elevated at a baseline. It's harder for those young people to kind of bring those physical reactions down. They feel less of a sense of control over their environment and fear. They're hypervigilant, always looking around the corner for the next threat in their environment, and just focusing on survival and not connecting with other young people and adults in the way that they should be. So I have a video, and I'm glad that this is the third or fourth presentation I've given with this video, and this will be the first time that it's actually worked, so I'm pretty excited about that. Let me just say before we get started, I should have mentioned this, but the noise that you're hearing, it's the sound of the mother blowing her nose into a tissue. Okay? So watch the baby's reaction.
Thank you. close your nose.
So it's a very cute video, and part of the reason I like showing it. But what it does, I think, demonstrate or illustrate for you is, you know, this is a very benign example of a mother who's just blowing her nose. But this is the kind of reaction that you expect to see from a teenager who was physically abused during their childhood. And if they perceive a threat in their environment, they have that reaction. You know, maybe not in the same way that the baby does. But when you remove that stressor, you know, they can get back to normal. The baby was laughing and smiling. But the minute that threat is back in the environment, you know, again, hypervigilance, and I think it's a good illustration of how trauma can impact your reactions. So once again, thinking about trauma and how to understand and recognize it, some of the things that you might see in a school, in a classroom, or on the playground, the fighting, the aggression and anger, behavior problems, recklessness, those are the things that you see on the surface. But in the top right corner of the slide here, you see an iceberg. If anyone knows the story of the Titanic didn't run straight into the iceberg. The reason the Titanic sunk is because it went right along the edge of the iceberg, mostly missed it, but it was all that ice underneath the surface of the water that tore a gash right through the side, and then the bottom, the hull filled up with water, and the ship sank. And the reason I'm using this as an illustration is because that's a good way of thinking about trauma. Sometimes what you see on the surface might be the fighting and the aggression and anger, the behavior problems, but what's going on underneath the surface? Because that's where the bulk of what's happening in that child's life, that's where it is. And that's where you might see things like sleep disturbances and withdrawal from friends and from family, or physical complaints, or changes in appetite. Things are a little bit harder to recognize and to identify. Guilt, fear, terror, shame. So again, just a way of thinking about how to identify these kids who might be experiencing trauma. One of the things that we like to talk to, particularly when we go to schools, is reframing this idea and changing this phrase of what's wrong with this student, what's wrong with you, and changing that into what happened to you. It really changes the way that you think about how to address behavior problems, for example, in the classroom. Because you're not asking the question in just out of pure frustration, what's wrong with this child, but reframing and thinking about, you know what, if I'm seeing this, I should be asking the question, what happened to this child? And how can I support this child in a different way to address the trauma that they may have experienced in their life and maybe nobody's ever asked them about? Okay, so that's a lot of bad news. You know, I know those numbers are scary, some of the things that you hear about, and they really are terrible things. They really are things that really impact children and families tremendously. But the good news is that children are resilient. If you take that child and their three-year-old brain out of that Romanian orphanage and put them in a healthy environment with parents who care for them and love them and lots of other of those developmental factors that raise functioning, you find that many kids get better and they don't exhibit signs of significant issues down the road. And that's because kids are very resilient. They respond to their environment in different ways. There's even research that shows that you can change the patterns of in your brain, the connections in your brain can be changed over time if you're placed into healthier environments. And the other good news is that there are effective treatments that exist for all the kinds of conditions I talked about earlier. But I think one thing that's often missed is that we must have systems that work effectively to identify kids that have behavioral health needs, to make sure that they have access to trauma-informed and evidence-based treatments, and that they're actually engaging in those treatments and they're being delivered to the kids who are most in need of them. So let's talk a little bit more about this role of behavioral health systems. I showed this figure earlier, and again, on the outer circles are things like policy and legislation and communities, things that affect child development. So why do systems matter? Well, we know that that has an impact as well as communities, neighborhoods, and also families and children themselves. And that's one of the reasons that in our work at CHDI, we take all of those into account. So I might be, we don't do direct clinical services with young people, but we provide a lot of training and workforce development to school-based clinicians and to child guidance clinicians to understand the role of trauma and its impact, for example, on kids. And we also work with legislators and with policymakers to make sure that the kinds of systems that are being put in place help to identify these young people early and that there are effective interventions that can be put into place. So we try to work at all these levels to try to impact change in Connecticut. I think it's a nice, I have a figure here that helps you understand a little bit about what gets in the way and why families and children might experience the mental health system as a very frustrating system. And we hear that all the time in the work that we do. Well, a system is supposed to be organized and purposeful structure that is interrelated and everything's working well together and achieves really specific goals. That's what a system does at its best. And in the mental health arena, this the system components, if you will, include certainly the children and families themselves who are in need of services, funders at the state and federal level, and Medicaid and commercial insurance providers, schools and social workers, psychologists, guidance counselors, community-based providers, I mentioned policymakers and legislators, advocates, researchers, evaluators, community members like yourselves. And those of you who are trained in mental health first aid are part of the system. Think of yourself as part of the system. And then certainly lots of other people who are involved in the system. But the question that we grapple with at CHDI and in lots of other places is, can families actually navigate the system to access services? So I put this slide together to give you just an example of how difficult it can be. So on the left side of your slide, you see children and families with behavioral health needs. And I know the writing's really small, so I'm going to read a few of these. On the right side are the provider networks. So this could be the hospitals or the school-based practitioners or community-based nonprofit providers who deliver effective treatments to young people. What everyone would love to be able to do is draw a straight line from the left side of this slide to the right side of the slide so that kids who have needs can access the services that they require. But in reality, what you have is a really complicated picture. At the state agency level, for example, you have the Department of Children and Families that's involved heavily in the business of providing and funding behavioral health services. But they're not the only ones. The Department of Social Services, which oversees the Medicaid program, and DMIS, the Mental Health and Addiction Services, oversees the adult side of the behavioral health system in the state of Connecticut. The State Department of Education, for schools that have students with behavioral health needs and it's impacting their learning, they are funding and paying for behavioral health services. Schools themselves, out of municipal budgets and special education dollars, are paying for behavioral health services. CSSD is the Court Support Services Division. So this is, they're providing behavioral health services to kids who are involved in the law enforcement and the juvenile justice system. The Office of Early Childhood is a state agency that deals with kids under five, and they're providing services for kids with mental health needs. Department of Public Health, the Department of Developmental Services are responsible for kids with autism. So as you can see, it's a very complicated picture, and that's just looking at the state agencies that are involved. Then in terms of how it gets paid for, you also have commercial insurance providers and employee-sponsored health plans and even federal or philanthropic funding sources that are paying for behavioral health. So as you can see, it can be very difficult for a family, particularly at a moment of crisis when they need services the most, to navigate this minefield of different entities that are paying for services and delivering services. And what's even more frustrating, I think, from my perspective, is that each one of these bubbles has different eligibility criteria for who can receive care and a different menu of services that they can deliver. So that depending on which door you're coming through, whether you're eligible for services or what kind of services you receive are sometimes completely different, depending on which door you enter through. So this is our challenge. Sometimes we throw our hands up in the air because it can be very difficult.
And Jeff, I would also say that within those bubbles, we don't necessarily know or feel like we have access to the resources within those bubbles. So if our resources aren't appropriate, how do we put families in touch with other potential resources and those are and what there is out there to be offered?
Right. Yeah, and that is, again, it can be because of the complexities of how the system in Connecticut is organized. And it's not just Connecticut. Lots of states really struggle to try to get this right. but we hear it all the time from schools, for example, about, you know, I can identify some of the kids who need services, but if they're commercially insured, they're not eligible for anything. That's something we hear all the time. I really know that this child needs this particular treatment, but you have to be involved in the juvenile justice system to get it. So I've heard stories personally from parents who have been advised by professionals, if you really want that service, go get your child arrested. Because if they get arrested, then they can get that treatment. This is the advice that we sometimes have to give families, and it's really scary that happens out in the state. And again, it's not just Connecticut, it's other places as well. So each has, again, their own set of eligibility criteria and a different menu of available services. And so the question begs to be asked, do we actually have a mental health system? Going back to that definition of being purposeful and structured and organized, there's a lot of people that might say, we don't really have a mental health system in the United States and not in the state of Connecticut, and we really need to do something about that. So that's a lot of the work that we do at CHDI, and not just us, lots of other people as well.
Is there a resource which designates what each of those bubbles are and who can have access to them? Is there some kind of...
Yeah. So the question essentially is there like a single point of entry that can help you understand what you can get from each one of those? And I would say that the answer to that is mostly a no. There are pockets of information where you can learn more, but a lot of times you need to be involved with that system to get that information. So it might be difficult to knock on the judicial branch's door to understand what services are available for juvenile justice involved kids unless you've been arrested, and you can't really access it until you...
So the state of Connecticut does not have a listing of these agencies for...
No, I mean, each one of these agencies has their own websites and resources that they make available to people. But again, I think the challenge and frustration is every one of those pieces of paper listing the resources is going to be very different. And eligibility to access those services depends on whether you're involved in that particular system. You know, the Office of the Healthcare Advocate Office of the Healthcare Advocate and also Sarah Egan and her work, and I'm blanking on the name of her state agency, but they do quite a bit of work to help people navigate the system. If you're commercially insured, the Connecticut Insurance Department can help you sift through the benefits and what you're entitled to through your commercial insurance plan. But there's really not like this central point of access where you can understand, you know, what's available to you. Okay, so yes, one more question.
On its most basic level, if going back to the beginning, if you have a 12-year-old who's in crisis, has not attempted suicide, but has all those other sort of symptoms, I'll call them, and you dial 211, what happens?
So that's part of the good news. 211 is one of the, and EMPS, the Mobile Crisis Service, is one of the few programs in the state of Connecticut that will go out and provide crisis stabilization services and linkages to the treatment system regardless of any of those criteria.
So
they
come to your house or
they will literally get in their car and drive to your house, drive to the school. I know that EMPS clinicians have met families in a McDonald's or in a parking lot or at a library to provide services. So that's one of the really beautiful things about EMPS is, first of all, it's available pretty much around the clock. You're gonna get a mobile response, meaning somebody's gonna get in the car and physically be in front of you between 6 o'clock in the morning and 10 o'clock at night, most days. And if it's after 10 o'clock at night, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning, something happens, if you dial 211, you're still gonna talk to a live, trained crisis clinician, and you'll get a mobile response from the EMPS the next morning. And they're never going to ask you, well, how are you paying for this? It's free, it's accessible regardless of what system you happen to be involved with or no system at all. If you're commercially insured, if you have Medicaid, it doesn't matter. They're going to come out and provide a response to you, and they're going to help you understand what to do next. So it's a great resource, but not all services work like that. It'd be nice if more of them did. So what do we want? What are we going for? What are we aiming for in a children's behavioral health system? First, from our perspective, that youth with behavioral health needs, all the things we talked about, anxiety, depression, attention deficit disorder, trauma, youth with behavioral health needs are identified early and have access to appropriate care. That's, at a very basic level, one of the things that we really want. We want services to be equitable, you know, so that if you have a need, regardless of other factors, you can get behavioral health treatment. And also to reduce behavioral health disparities in the state, because not just in Connecticut, but throughout the country, we know that people who are in poverty, racial and ethnic minority groups, have higher prevalence rates of many mental health conditions. And so there's a tremendous need in certain pockets and communities of the state of Connecticut where the prevalence and the need is really high. And we need to make services available to the populations that need it the most so that those young people don't experience negative life outcomes down the road because they couldn't access the services that they need. So there's a lot of work to be done there. We want to have a full comprehensive service array that's available to all families based on what their treatment needs are and not based on where they happen to live or which system they're involved with. We want to work to have providers who are trained and receive the kind of support that they need to deliver the most effective cutting-edge treatments that are available out there. There's lots of evidence-based treatments to address trauma, to address anxiety and depression, but not every clinician and or social worker or psychologist you work with has been trained in those things, and so there's a workforce development need that exists. We also want services to be supported by data so that we can understand what the needs are, where they exist, who's receiving services, and what the outcomes are. And too often, there's not sufficient data to understand any of those factors. Again, we want the best possible outcomes, and we want to keep expenditures in check. You know, there's not, and people who have been reading the Connecticut Mirror or paying attention to the news in the state of Connecticut know that the state budget is bad and probably getting worse over the next couple of years. So there's a real need to make sure that what we are delivering and paying for is effective and that it's delivered in a cost-effective way. So we do have a blueprint for all of this, and you can go to planforchildren.org and read up on the Children's Behavioral Health Plan. And this is a document and a framework for structuring the children's behavioral health system to accomplish the goals that we were talking about today, making services accessible to kids in an equitable way, emphasis on evidence-based practice, access to data, all those things are articulated in the plan. It's very long. I know that because I wrote most of it. So if there is an executive summary that's about 10 or 12 or 15 pages, it gives you some of the high points. If you're really, really interested, you can read the big 90-pager. But it does provide a blueprint, and there has been some action to implement some of that work over the last couple of years. So we're moving into the next goal that I talked about earlier, understanding a little bit more about effective behavioral health interventions for youth. And I think the first thing to understand is that the services are organized on a continuum from the least intensive services to the most intensive. And so on the least intensive side, actually before the presentation was getting started, you were talking about mental health first aid. And that's actually something that's not on this, but it really should be, because as part of the workforce and understanding the importance of early identification and early intervention, those people who are trained in mental health first aid can be really sort of an effective and low intensity response for kids that have behavioral health needs. For kids whose needs exceed that, you've got the EMPS system, which we just talked about, care coordination services, which provide wraparound services for kids who are at risk of out-of-home placement. There's a whole range of school-based services that are available from guidance counselors and social workers and psychologists. Then you have outpatient services delivered in your child guidance clinics. I think probably the closest one to Simsbury is probably Wheeler Clinic. I don't know if they have a Simsbury Clinic site, but Wheeler Clinic covers a lot of this geographic area. In fact, the EMPS team that covers Simsbury is from Wheeler Clinic. You also have a range of intensive in-home services. So for those kids whose problems really exceed what can be provided in a school or in an outpatient environment, maybe they're appropriate for an intensive in-home services. And these are clinicians who will come out to your home and provide 2 or 3 days a week of an hour or two session for those kids who really have a more intensive behavioral health need. They're also at the intermediate level of care, not home-based, but clinic or center-based programs like extended day treatment, which is, think of it as sort of like a therapeutic after-school program. A lot of kids will go to school in their home school, but then from 2 o'clock until 5 or 6, they're participating in therapeutic environment like extended day treatment or intensive outpatient program. And for kids who really have much more intensive needs, there are inpatient hospitalization, which used to be 2 or 3 weeks. You could be in an inpatient stay for 2 or 3 weeks. Nowadays, it's 2 or 3 days in inpatient. Some kids will show up at the emergency department to access behavioral health care, which is not a great way to access these services. It can be an entry into the system, but by and large, you're not going to get the kind of treatment you're expecting in an emergency department, because there's lots of other things going on in an ED. And then psychiatric residential treatment facilities. So what's happened over the last few years in the state of Connecticut and lots of other places, there's been more and more emphasis about reducing the number of kids who are in this deep end of the system and building up this part of the system up here. Because the idea is that you're much more likely to be able to catch young people early who are exhibiting the early signs and symptoms if your services are available in a school. And you have an EMPS that will go no matter what's happening and respond to a crisis. These ends of the treatment continuum are necessary. They should be part of the system, but they've really been scaled back over the last several years because the research is a little bit spotty about the effectiveness of things like residential treatment. And also, they're extremely costly. They're very costly. And the evidence is much better for things like an intensive in-home service. And so there's been a lot of emphasis in the state about moving more of the system in that direction. We started to talk about this already, but we'll touch on it again because it is really important. If you're concerned about a young person, they're exhibiting signs and symptoms of suicidality or severe anxiety, or they're refusing to go to school or really acting out at home, you have the EMPS system available to you. And it just happens that we have probably one of the best, if not the best, mobile crisis program in the country, in the state of Connecticut. Because it's accessible to all kids, because they respond quickly, and we have a lot of capacity to cover the entire state. You go to other places, like I know of an excellent program in Wisconsin, but it's only available for kids who live in Milwaukee County. So if you live outside of that area, you may not be able to access the mobile crisis program. Connecticut, we have an EMPS program that covers the entire state. So crisis is defined by the caller. I know historically schools have only called EMPS when they have concerns about suicidality, for example. But one of the things that we're trying to really promote in the state of Connecticut is that EMPS will respond for things that are much less severe than that. So if you have concerns about your child or a student in your classroom, call 211. It's free of charge for children in the state. It can help you avoid that emergency department trip, which may not in the end be all that helpful for you, and to provide crisis stabilization, assessment, and follow-up for up to 45 days. But even that 45-day window is somewhat arbitrary, because if a family calls EMPS again at the end of 45 days, EMPS will just come out again. So really, they can be a resource that really is responsive to needs. Their goal is to, if they're getting 2 or 3 or 4 calls a month from a family, I think their needs probably exceed what EMPS can provide. So the EMPS clinician will try to link that family up with outpatient care or with an intensive in-home service, whatever the level of need is for that family. So since we redesigned this system, the EMPS system, several years ago, this chart shows you how many kids and families are using the service. And this actually doesn't even go back as far as 2009, when there were about 5,000 episodes of care serving maybe 3,000 children per year. These days, my 2016 report is about to come out, so I'm not sure exactly what the 16 number looks like. But as you can see here, there's almost 12,500 episodes of care in 2015, serving almost 8,000 kids. So the program has probably grown by 2 to 3 times over the last 5 or 6 years in terms of how many kids that they're seeing in a year. And I view that as a good thing. I mean, you may think, oh boy, that's a lot of kids in crisis. But I think those kids were probably that many kids in crisis before that weren't calling EMPS and were doing other things. Yes?
In your graph there, you had a percentage listed on the, each of the bars.
Yep.
What is that percentage?
Yeah, good question, good question. So the total, if you add two, these two together, for example, in 2015, the number of calls, this is the total number of calls that come into 211. There's a certain percentage about, actually this is flipped, this should be 25%, and this should be 75%. I've never noticed that before. 75% of those kids will get an EMPS response. The other 25% of those calls are actually for other non-behavioral health related concerns. So the 211 system, if you know 211, they, if you smell gas in your basement, you can call 211 to find out, you know, who needs to come out and fix a gas leak. And so some of those calls will make their way through and are screened out and sent somewhere else. So that's the red part that are screened out. But the blue part, 75% of all calls coming in, are calls that get an EMPS response. Okay. And just to drive the point home a little bit further, what we're finding when we look at the outcomes of EMPS care, that kids get better, that crisis issues resolve over time. And when you take, you measure their clinical functioning when you first see them in EMPS and then measure it again at discharge, we're seeing that there are significant reductions in problem behavior and how both the clinicians and their parents or caregivers are experiencing the behavior problems. So significant impact on behavior. Part of that is because you're entering into the EMPS system at a moment of crisis when things are pretty bad, and then maybe you're filling out that discharge measure when things have settled down quite a bit, but that's partly due because of the EMPS intervention that you've received. The other thing I like to point out with EMPS is that if you compare the cost of an EMPS intervention to an inpatient stay, there's a tremendous savings, so to speak. And inpatient stays might average 3 or 4 days, whereas an EMPS episode of care can last for 2 or 3 weeks or 4 weeks or even a little bit longer. And it's provided in a very cost-effective way. So there's a lot of emphasis on making EMPS available because it can help prevent that young person from having to go to the emergency department or requiring an inpatient stay. So that's an important factor. I started to talk a little bit about the behavioral health needs of young people who are involved in the juvenile justice system. And if you were to walk into a juvenile justice facility right now, remembering those prevalence numbers I talked about before, about 20% of all young people have signs and symptoms of behavioral health concerns. In a juvenile justice facility, that might be 50, 60, 70%. So there's a tremendous overlap of behavioral health needs among the juvenile justice involved population. So some of the thinking has been, well, those are the real needs, the underlying needs of those youth. Shouldn't we make behavioral health services available to them instead of having them get involved with the juvenile justice system and be incarcerated over time? And again, if you're reading the papers and the news, you might have noticed that there's a lot going on right now about the closure of Connecticut Juvenile Training School, CJTS. And I think this is part of an effort to see fewer kids entering into the juvenile justice system if their needs can be addressed in other ways. And so we helped to develop the school-based diversion initiative. The reason we helped develop this is because 20% of all referrals to the juvenile justice system were coming from school incidents. So a fight happens at school, a student is not responding to a teacher's request to follow a rule, and maybe start swearing, something like that. Many of those kids are ending up in the juvenile justice system. Some of them are ending up incarcerated. And there's a lot of really good data out there showing that if you access behavioral health services as an alternative to juvenile justice, that your long-term outcomes are much, much better. Kids who are arrested are twice as likely to not graduate from high school. Kids who are arrested and then processed through the court system are 4 times as likely to not graduate from high school. So the deeper into that system you get, and I think the worse your outcomes can be. So we try to develop programs to keep kids out of the juvenile justice system whenever possible and link them up with behavioral health services. And we've had some really great effects in our school-based diversion initiative. We've seen school-based court referrals go down 45% on average in the schools we've worked with, and referrals to our EMPS system up 94%. So we're really pleased about that effectiveness there. The trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy program, raise your hand if you've heard of TFCBT, trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy. So this is one of the most highly evidence-based interventions available for kids who have been exposed to trauma. It's funded by the Department of Children and Families, as well as the Court Support Services Division. So for kids who are justice involved in some way, maybe they're on probation, those young people are able to access a trauma-focused CBT program. So it's a family-centered treatment, relatively short-term, but the evidence for effectiveness is really, really strong. It's available for kids who are between 4 and 17 years old, and it's now we've been involved with training 35 or more outpatient clinics across the state of Connecticut to access trauma-focused CBT. Now again, and that's a referral through the outpatient service, so you don't have to be DCF involved. If you are involved with the court system, you've been arrested or you're on probation, you also have access to trauma-focused CBT. And again, the ratings of trauma symptoms, this is a measure of trauma symptoms that you're looking at, from pre-test to post-test, you see a real reduction in trauma reaction symptoms. And that's according to the child's own report, as well as the parent reporting on the child's behavior. So again, we're very excited about the significant improvements we're seeing from kids who are participating in that program. Also in the outpatient system, we have what's called the Modular Approach to Therapy for Children. It's a very, very long title for children with anxiety, depression, trauma, and conduct problems. So we call it MATCH for short. This is another program that's available in outpatient clinics. It was developed by Dr. John Weiss at Harvard University. It's funded by DCF to be available for any kid in outpatient care. So again, this is a family-centered short-term treatment. And you remember that slide about the four most common presenting problems to outpatient? What's really nice about this program is that it trains clinicians in an evidence-based approach to addressing anxiety, depression, trauma problems, or chronic problems. So any one of those four things. And they can use modules and switch between an anxiety treatment module into a trauma module and then over to a conduct, depending on what the needs are of that young people. And for about 70% of kids who are walking into an outpatient clinic door, MATCH is going to be appropriate for them. So that's a really, really efficient one to invest in, right? Because it covers a lot of ground. And again, we're seeing really significant impacts. It's still a fairly small number of kids that have completed treatment, but we're seeing some really exciting initial outcomes from that work. CBITS stands for the Cognitive Behavioral Intervention for Trauma in Schools. So the last two I shared with you were outpatient-based treatments, so you have to go to a Wheeler clinic or another place to get those. CBITS is something that is available in schools, and we will train school-based clinicians to deliver this. It's a group-based program. In Connecticut, the technical assistance is provided by Dr. Sharon Steffen from the University of Maryland. And it's for kids from 5 to 17 years old. And actually, I think there's a program for younger kids as well. There are now about 60 different CBITS groups at 18 different schools in 4 districts across the state. So this one's still growing, and we're working on disseminating this to more schools. So far, 288 children have been enrolled, and we're expecting to train about 60 or more school-based clinicians by 2017. And once again, really good initial outcomes looking at the effectiveness of this treatment for young people. So I talk a lot about evidence-based treatments because I'm a big believer in evidence-based treatments. I think it helps therapists kind of structure the interventions that they're providing based on what's known from the science to be most effective for kids with these needs. And as you can see from this figure, the number of kids who are receiving evidence-based treatments has really grown from 2008 to where we are today. And it will grow more as we're adding more of these models in the state of Connecticut. If you want to learn about whether an evidence-based practice is available in your community, you can go to the kidsmentalhealthinfo.com website, and you can search a directory. If you type in the name of your town or your zip code, it will tell you, and then click which evidence-based treatments you're interested in. It'll tell you where the nearest clinic is to you. So that's a really, really great resource. So summarizing just some of the points here that we've talked about today. First, there's certainly a lot of need out there. The prevalence of mental health conditions among young people is high. Looks like I got a plug in here. Mm-hmm. I think we'll make it through. Prevalence is high, there's a tremendous amount of need, but we are working on developing service systems that are effective to identify early and to make sure treatments are available and accessible to kids. We're placing in the state of Connecticut a lot more emphasis on home, school, and community-based care that's effective and cost-effective. And I think a better understanding of trauma is we're really starting to develop that area in the state. And I think there's going to be a lot more work to really help schools and probation officers and parents and community leaders to understand the impact of trauma and how it affects kids. One of the pieces of good news is that Connecticut is a national leader in delivering evidence-based care. So if I go to a national conference, which I do, I go to a couple at least every year, we talk about the system that Connecticut's got with respect to evidence-based treatments, and people are just blown away by what we have here in the state. The problem is not every kid can access these interventions. So that's the work that remains to be done. And another good piece of news that we've got good outcomes data. It shows that these treatments are effective. They're working for kids and for families. And we also are really increasing our awareness of health equity and disparities, and we're looking to make sure that it's not that it's working for everyone, but that particularly for those populations that really have high prevalence and need, making sure that it's effective for them. And so we're doing a lot of work to like look at outcomes data, but split it according to the gender of the child or their race or ethnicity and things like that to make sure that it's equally effective for everyone. Some of our ongoing challenges, I think system change is really hard. It's a messy process. It takes a long time. You know, getting a line of mental health policy into a bill in the state legislature can take you years. So it's a lot of work. And once that's in there, you still have to do the work, right? And we've been on that end of things too, where there's a piece of legislation that comes out and then everybody's scrambling trying to figure out how are we going to make this happen. So system change is very difficult, but it's really important. State budget is going to be a big issue, especially over the next few years. I think resources are going to be very scarce for this work. It's going to have to be very efficient about how we deliver it. I think another challenge is there's pockets of excellent work going on, but maybe it's only available in one school or in one community. And I think one of the challenges that we have is identifying things that we know work well and scaling it up to make it more accessible. And also moving away from things that don't work. And we have, you know, there are some programs that get funding where maybe there aren't outcomes collected at all. Or maybe the outcomes that are collected show that it's not particularly effective. And I think as a state, we need to have the courage to move towards things that we know work and move away from things that there's no evidence that it's working very well. And I think always getting effective interventions to the individuals that need them the most is going to be an ongoing challenge. So with that, I'll open it up to any questions or discussion.
Jeff, I think one of the, I know, one of the aspects of our mission of our group for Community for Care is to provide resources surrounding the issues of mental health. So I really thank you for this discussion, which was primarily focused on our children. But I think also one of the things that this group, and I think we struggle with as a whole, is the stigma surrounding mental health. So it's certainly, there might be resources to access,
yeah.
But parents might be afraid to kind of admit that there could be an issue, never mind making those connections to those resources. Mm-hmm. In your work, in the work of your group, is there specific focus on the reduction of that stigmas associated with mental health?
Yeah, I think it's an excellent point. I think mental health and mental illness is stigmatized in a way that I think no other kinds of conditions are really experienced. So, you know, a lot of, I think of, for many young people and adults who struggle with mental illness, that it really the corollary is something like diabetes. So it's something that you have to watch your diet and you need to take your insulin shots and you have to maintain your treatment protocol to manage that illness. But nobody is, you know, it's much less likely that somebody is going to look down on you or think that you're weak if you tell them that you have diabetes. I think what a lot of young people and adults experience when they have mental health conditions is a lot of fear and a lot of judgment. And I think that can be a strong disincentive for somebody, A, admitting that things aren't going well for them, or B, accessing services that are available that we know work. So there's a real, I think there needs to be even more emphasis on getting young people and families involved and educated about mental health. Some of the public awareness campaigns and things that you might see on a billboard, we were seeing more of those things being made available. School-based initiatives where students are educating one another and their peers about mental health concerns and identifying things that are happening and helping access resources. I think that peer-to-peer connection is something that we don't often think of in the mental health world, but can be a really powerful influence for reducing stigma. So in my opinion, there's not enough of that work going on, but there is some, and I think we do actively kind of work on promoting some of those kinds of public awareness and stigma reduction campaigns. And there's a great advocacy community in the state of Connecticut that's really interested in that kind of work as well. So I think in particular about FAVOR and AFCAMP. Those are two family advocacy organizations that really help educate parents about mental health. Of course, NAMI, there's a Connecticut chapter of the National Alliance of Mental Illness in the state of Connecticut that's very active. And these are all institutions that really care deeply about stigma and stigma reduction. Yes?
I didn't hear you mention pediatricians and all of that, and I was wondering where they fit into the system. It's usually the first point of contact for a child who's ill or has had an injury, which may have been traumatic or not. How do you advise families to, you know, go through their pediatrician? Perhaps that's a method of getting a referral. Does that work? Does it not work?
Yeah, it's a great point. I think pediatricians are a really important component of the system, and I should make sure that I go back in my slides to highlight some of that. They are often the first line of defense. They do field a lot of questions from parents who have concerns about their three-year-old or four-year-old showing signs of something they're not quite sure. I think the challenge is that pediatricians in medical school get little to no training in mental health. So workforce development and understanding mental health conditions, I think, is something that you have to be working with the pediatricians through continuing medical education and other programs. At CHDI, we have a program called EPIC. It's called Educating Practices in the Community. And we have people who go out to pediatric offices and have modules on all kinds of things, trauma, mental health, all kinds of different health conditions, and really try to provide that continuing medical education to pediatricians so that they can be better informed about the role of mental health and who to refer to. There's also, in the state of Connecticut, I didn't mention, Access Mental Health. And Access Mental Health is, there are three hubs in the state of Connecticut, and it's a service that's available to any pediatric practice in the state. And I wish I had the contact information off the top of my head, but if you look up Access Mental Health on Google it and look into the website, it'll tell you more about that program. But what that offers is, if a pediatrician has a family sitting in front of them and they start talking about mental health and the pediatrician says, boy, this is kind of beyond my level of comfort or my experience or my training, let me get some consultation from a psychiatrist who can help me out. Pick up the phone, dial Access Mental Health, and you're gonna talk to a psychiatrist or a mental health clinician who can help walk that pediatrician through what they're seeing and how they can access resources. And that's another one that's free and available, I think, to pretty much anybody who walks into a pediatric office. So it's a great question. I'm glad you brought it up, because I do think that pediatricians are a really important component of the system.
Has there been a state effort to educate school nurses concerning mental health? Because often they're the doorway to understanding what's going on.
Yeah, absolutely. I think classroom teachers, even before that, oftentimes. Teachers, guidance counselors, even there was a police officer here earlier, I wish he would have stayed. Sometimes it can be the school resource officer who notices something. Making that connection to the school nurse and the other mental health providers in the school system, I think, is a great way to get access to treatment. There are some efforts of school-based health centers available in the state of Connecticut. I think there are about 100 school-based health centers. One piece of data I didn't share is that, you know, even though most kids who have mental health conditions won't access treatment, remember that 80%, 70 to 80% don't, if you are receiving any kind of mental health treatment, what do you think is the most common place that you're going to be receiving it? It's in the schools, from a nurse or a social worker. So the role of, again, developing the workforce within the school system to identify mental health needs, to be able to deliver some interventions, and also know if this kind of goes beyond our capacity to meet the needs of this young person, what's the next step for me? How can I connect to my child guidance clinic and access some of the services that we were talking about earlier? So that's an excellent point around the role of schools. And I think you had a follow-up question.
I was just wondering, for the kids who have a chronic condition, they're receiving special education services, they might have a genetic disorder, autism, something like that, and are probably might be taking medication from a very young age.
Mm-hmm.
Those type of behavioral and mental health issues, and a lot of times there are mental health diagnoses that go along with, mm-hmm. with those conditions. I've seen parents particularly bewildered by how to access not only the pediatrician, which was where I was starting, that the pediatrician doesn't really understand, or probably just for lack of experience, the impact of those medications on certain behaviors, and then you need a psychiatrist who mm-hmm. can prescribe those medications because the pediatrician can't do it, and it becomes even more complicated than that. And I'm just wondering if there's another level of intervention for those families.
Great question. For part of the reason I think over the last several years, there's been a real particular challenge around kids with autism is, first of all, more and more kids are being diagnosed with autism than ever before. The numbers have really skyrocketed in terms of how frequently it's being diagnosed. I think the second issue is that it's a very specialized treatment that's known to be effective for kids with autism. Not every mental health clinician or counselor you run across is going to know how to treat autism, and certainly not every pediatrician. So I'm aware of, this is not a program that I'm directly involved with, but I know of it. Beacon Health Options used to be called Value Options. They help administer the Medicaid system in the state of Connecticut for children and adults with behavioral health needs. I know they have done a lot of work over the last couple of years based on some legislation that came out to develop a registry of certified autism specialists so that if you are a child of autism, you can access resources and information about services through Beacon, and that was not available a couple of years ago. So there's been a lot of work to develop a better autism, a better network of providers who can address the needs of children with autism. Any other questions? Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to be here.
Funding for Simsbury Community Television is provided in part by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.